It took me nearly an hour to discuss all of the problems with this 9-minute scene, and as has been shown through many of your own comments, I still didn't even get everything that could have been discussed. And with that, I think it would be a fair assumption to make that not only do I dislike the scene, but also that this film is just pure trash when it comes to historical authenticity and respect for the past. Yet, this is not completely the case. Truth be told, I actually enjoy this scene. Despite all of its problems, the majority of which, let's be perfectly clear, are simplistic and silly, I think that the overall aesthetic that it has, the overall feeling which it seeks to evoke in the viewer, is really quite respectful and positive. While this scene is by no means historically accurate, I do think that it at least has a sense of historical authenticity. So in this, our final part, let's end on a high note and go over the good parts of this scene. A warning to you all, though, I shall be waxing quite poetic. We'll start here with the battle itself just about to begin. Now, of course, we start the scene as many of these sorts of films do. On one side, a ragtag militia is assembling for battle, clearly in a state of disarray as they are not professional soldiers. On the other, we hear only the steady and martial beating of drums while set and unmoving lines of regular troops are ready to advance. When the regulars do begin their advance, we see the colors flying as music is struck up. A few further comparison shots, we see the rebels preparing to receive the foe, and the regulars advancing steadily. All the while, we hear artillery blazing in the distance, the stamping of feet upon the ground, the pounding of drums, pealing of fifes and bugles, the cries of commands. Again, all fairly standard for these sorts of films. But with a shot of our heroes, suddenly things change. We hear the father ask one question of his son. See him. We flash to a young rebel militiaman, no more than a boy, really, staring ahead to the unseen advancing menace. His mouth hung slack, his eyes held wide. He has never seen anything so impressive and terrifying. He fears, perhaps for the first time ever, for his life. While prior we had heard a motley of sounds, now our audio is limited, our ears cut off to the world, as if we, like the boy, are in terror of what is soon to come. A morose and high-pitched theme begins to play just above the steady advance of the British soldiers. Now an old man looks forward, a clear opposite to the boy. His face is weathered from the years of labor and dirtied with stubble. His eyes, aged and experienced eyes, which we might expect to be filled with the wisdom of an old farmer, hold only anticipation and fear. Another face of similar countenance, an able man aiming his piece down the field, finger tight upon the trigger. We see in him as well that same anticipation and total focus on that which lies directly ahead of him. But we focus not long on the man, instead panning up to another child, a drummer boy. He swallows hard, unable to move his own gaze from the advancing terror. In the distance, we finally hear another voice as a rebel officer gives the order to fire. A faceless volley is unleashed upon the British lines, and we see a small number of regulars fall to the dirt. As the firing continues, being now the only thing we hear above the whining and high-pitched song, more regulars fall, one over another, as the musketry pierces into them, and their comrades are made to step over the bodies to take their places. A shot from the back, and still we see that thin red line advancing, pushing ever onwards through a hellish fire into an obscured field, unable to even see the beast which inflicts these wounds upon them. More and more comes musketry and artillery, and above the drumbeats and explosions, we hear only the same dreaded note continually rising in intensity, as if a ringing in our own ears from the physical and moral shock we are seeing unfold before us. We look again from the rear of the advance and see the trail of corpses left in its wake, like a great beast shedding itself against the stones. The bodies shudder on the ground, attempting to crawl away to find some non-existent safety, and through it all we hear a terrible scream of pain and shock. As the regulars advance, their legs tearing past the desperate entreaties of their fallen brothers, finally another command is heard over the din and chaos, and finally the soldiers may throw back against their unseen foe. The volley of the regulars tears into the militia, and their line begins to buckle. A second, it bends, and with a third, shatters into pieces. As the rebels fall back, every man among them running for their lives, they are cut down just as the British were. None dare to stop for their fellows as the wounded crawl desperately in an attempt to find some sort of sanctuary. An officer, brandishing his sword, exalts and begs of his men to remember their cause, to stand and to fight, but to no avail as the rout continues. Still, men are cut down in their attempts to escape, falling in grimaces of pain, forgotten in the desperate rush. Again to the regulars, and the command comes for them to level bayonets. Again the drumbeats are taken up, and we hear the steady intonation of a quick march. We see the juggernaut advance, leaving behind, as before, the fallen and now lifeless elements of its own body. More forgotten bodies as the rebels struggle to find shelter, running from the smoke-covered field as if fleeing not from men, but a force of nature. The second line is formed as a desperate attempt is made to reinforce, but on the sight of the advancing bayonets and further artillery fire, it too breaks down completely. Some brave souls attempt to stand, firing against the beast in a defiant rage, but to no effect. The line continues to advance upon them, and through the smoke overtakes the rebel defenses. We hear only the shouts of men, the panic of a horse, and the desperate scream of a boy. The regulars advance still as a great beast, an inhuman entity which cannot be thrown back despite the vain attempts to resist it. Still, we hear only the screaming of men, the pounding of drums, and the increasing intensity of the music. As the final line is thoroughly shattered, another command shouted as if in euphoria and in terror both, to charge the fleeing enemy and to cut them down. We hear still more boys and women, girls, followers of the rebel force, all screaming for their own lives. A desperate attempt is made to stand, assembly calling the militia to one final point of defiance round their colors. Our hero struggles to fix a rusted and bent bayonet to his piece, but against the zeal and the rage of the regulars, soon throws it aside and runs to safety, trying to save his son, who is shouting for his father. The rebels are pushed to a ridge, and with one final rush of the regulars are forced to jump for their lives. As the shattered remains of the rebel forces run, the regulars stand triumphant on the ridge. They cry out in jubilation for their triumph, and relief for their survival. The battle is over. Well, I did warn you about the poetry, didn't I? So like I said, I actually really enjoy the scene, despite all of its problems. And that is for one core reason, something that all too many films set in a period of linear conflict do not seem to understand. That this kind of warfare is, like all others, a terrible and terrifying thing. It doesn't matter that the men are wearing colorful uniforms, that they're flying beautiful banners or playing nice music. You can gussy and pretty it up all you want with these talks of glory and honor, of zeal and heroism, but at its absolute core, war is hell. And at the very least, it seems like this particular scene genuinely appreciates that. This scene actually respects the historical memory which it seeks to preserve in its portrayal, even if it doesn't necessarily get all of the little details correct. If only the rest of the movie was like this, because you see, while there are definitely a good few similar scenes that really portray things quite well in this film, there are oh so many others that honestly just spit in the face of the past. Indeed, this entire film, strangely enough, is just one massive juxtaposition of good and bad, and they are always, it seems, in such close proximity to each other. It's enough to completely boggle the mind. So let me show you just a few more really quick examples to explain what I mean, starting with what may well be the worst scene in the entire film. So long story short, in this part, our hero happens to have been taken prisoner and is here being used by those evil redcoats as literal human bait in a fox hunt.
Soft spot for him, are we? I think we'll have to put him out of his misery. So ends the American dream, eh, what?
And I cannot even begin to fathom what inspired this god-awful portrayal of a British officer. Honestly, even if this sort of thing did happen, and I mean, hey, it's not like it's completely beyond belief. Honestly, I am far more angered just by this one character, no matter what he's doing in the film. I genuinely don't know what's worse, the accent, the makeup, the terrible laughing, and the tally-ho. It's like they took every bad stereotype of a posh Englishman you could imagine, they combined them all into one, and intended for it to be taken seriously, instead of as the pure comedy that it is. And yet, whether you'd believe it or not, the scene immediately following this one, this terrible, inhuman, demonizing portrayal of the British, we have this, the Sergeant Major reading prayers over their fallen comrades, and attempting to comfort a young boy struggling to comprehend the terrible consequences of war. A humanizing look at the suffering, the genuine privations that are always involved with conflict.
In with a spade.
Is me going next?
No, his drummers look.
Like you.
Right, like him.
You can't fight a war without drummer boys, son. Now we've got some more.
And even more humanizing and pitying to the British and their own struggle in this conflict, we have at the end of the film a portrayal of the siege of Yorktown, and particularly its aftermath, where we see this. A British redoubt with a set of colors frayed and torn. Piles of bodies mangled and mutilated, the survivors cradling their wounds, wandering aimlessly among their fallen brothers, incapable of comprehending the sheer terror of what they had undergone. A scene terrible in its beauty and the emotion that it evokes, a showing again of the hell that is war. Had I not seen it myself, I could never believe that this scene, deep and emotional and respectful of the sacrifice and the loss of these men fighting in a strange and foreign land for a cause that was not their own, could ever be paired with scenes like this. It's as if the film has no self-awareness, as if it were made by two completely different groups of writers and directors and the like, a strange and freakish mashing of Waterloo and The Patriot. And of course, these are not the only examples. The film is just rife with these strange juxtapositions of really good and really bad portrayals. Depending on how you edit it all together, this could be an intense and wonderful historical drama that acknowledges the triumph, the sacrifice of war. Or a bad comedy which features a sniper team and their elite team of Native Americans fighting the evil, stereotypical redcoats. And then, of course, there's always those more pedantic of details, the sorts of which require over an hour of whinging for every 10 minutes of original footage. But all of that being said, I suppose we can, at the very least, be thankful for those few decent scenes that we do get. Those rare, proper portrayals of the pomp and the splendor, of the madness and the chaos, and of the humanity and the tragedy of conflict in the 18th century. Until the next time, my dear viewer, I am and I shall remain your most humble and obedient of servants.